In this audio recording, I'm going to be talking about AMR typologies. This is an upgraded extract of a speech at a public conference in Taipei, Taiwan in June 2012. Typologies for training. Firstly, this list of 27 typologies is not exhaustive. There are many others, especially for CFT, for example, cross-border ATM transactions. The typologies discussed are mostly from FATF reports and other topical issues highlighted in public reports such as the US annual INCSR. For CFT, I have made a separate audio recording. Let's now talk about these AML typologies one by one. I will give you a high-level overview only. Corruption and PEPs. Transparency's annual Corruption Perception Index is a good indication of country corruption risk. FATF 40 revised principles pays emphasis on identifying domestic PEPs and PEPs of international organizations and states clearly that the risk-based approach cannot be applied to foreign PEPs. Supervisors expect tight controls around PEP identification and data maintenance, including an easily accessible PEP database, which has periodic reviews from compliance for completeness and accuracy. Importantly, watch out for head of state and deputy heads accounts and linked accounts. In many countries, for example Taiwan, such heads of state when out of office have been known to be investigated for corruption. As bankers know, PEPs move their corruption monies through associated persons, gatekeepers, and offshore vehicles and accounts. Hence, effective AML requires an assessment of corruption-related risk and protecting against the laundering of corruption proceeds across the spectrum of customers and business relationships, regardless of whether a PEP is involved. For example, a corporate vehicle involved in a high-risk industry in which the role of the beneficial owner in a transaction is unclear, for example, could also be considered a higher risk, regardless of whether a PEP has been identified. Please see FATF guidance, Special Risk Factors in Laundering the Proceeds of Corruption, June 2012, and Laundering the Proceeds of Corruption, June 2011, for further details. Let's move on to the second typology, which is international drug trafficking. The US has an annual list of major illicit drug transit and drug producing countries and separately a list of major precursor chemical source countries. Moreover, wherever there is local demand, example for synthetic drugs, and where smuggling is rampant with enforcement gaps, there you can expect a country-specific problem. Generally with drugs, cash transactions can be expected. Watch for patterns of smurfing and many accounts transferring funds to the same third party. Moreover, banknotes, correspondent banking, and wire transfers can be misused for moving funds from overseas. Monies could have been moved overseas originally through bulk cash smuggling. Importantly, country risk ranking should be based on the intrinsic risk rather than any affiliate operations. Also refer to the US list of major money laundering countries. Besides AML controls, sanctions is of course one key approach to this problem. Lastly, one interesting new development is an online website called Silk Road, which is the eBay for illegal drugs existing on the deep web and operated as a Tor hidden service, Tor being a special browser, and it uses bitcoins or BTC to settle transactions. The site has US$21.5 million annual sales worldwide. Moving on to the third typology, which is human trafficking. Trafficking is essentially modern-day slavery and includes forced labor, sexual exploitation, including through migrant worker exploitation. Trafficking is a global business worth US$32 billion a year. The US annual Trafficking in Persons report places countries into one of three tiers based on the extent of their government's efforts to comply with the minimum standards for the elimination of trafficking. Expect cash transactions and other transactions, including credit card transactions, in accounts of registered small-time employment agencies and genuine businesses, such as licensed manufacturers of branded goods in poor countries and other front businesses. An example of a front business is, for example, a US$400 manicure and pedicure at 4 a.m. should be regarded as highly unusual and indicated of something other than the salon's typical services. Moving on to the fourth typology, IPR theft. IP theft costs the US economy $300 billion a year, and China accounts for between 50 and 80% of IP theft. The US has a special 301 watch list for IPR protection and enforcement. Unfortunately, IP theft is widely tolerated and indulged in by consumers. Banks should expect quasi-legitimate businesses with regular need for banking services, including trade finance, validating manufacturing license or the right to produce, to reproduce, is one key check, although not foolproof, as licensed manufacturers can simply overproduce and sell it illegally directly to the market. Expect cash transactions and transactions of small-time registered trader businesses, as well as of licensed manufacturers of branded goods. There is a proposal in the US to create drug and terrorism type sanctions for IP theft offenders, ban on imports, and blacklisting in financial markets. Lastly, another growing problem is, of course, of counterfeit pharmaceuticals, which I'm going to discuss as a separate typology. So typology 5, counterfeit pharmaceuticals. Criminal networks are raking in billions of dollars. As a key fact, it's more lucrative to traffic in illegitimate drugs than cocaine or heroin. The UN states that in some parts of Africa, Asia and Latin America, more than 30% of the medicines on sale can be fake. China is a key production center in Asia. Expect monies to go through accounts of small-time registered pharmacies, that is the end retailers, although distributors also play a key role working through retailers. Moreover, there could be unlicensed online pharmacies selling counterfeit goods, doing credit and debit transactions with the top banks. These are processed through countries like Azerbaijan and Nevis West Indies. Card-issuing banks need to adopt a blacklisting approach to online pharmacies. Moving on to the sixth typology, which is fake IDs and fraud. As you may be aware, using the internet and some equipment, it's really quite easy to make a fake ID. For example, in Taiwan, a national ID card costs Taiwan $10,000 and a driver's license costs Taiwan $5,000. China forgers supply the US and other countries on the net. These are typically sold as novelty items. Obviously, the use of genuine ID which does not belong to the person using it is safer for a criminal than the use of a fake ID. It's difficult to control the fraud at account opening through manual scrutiny, which needs significant training. ID scanners for verification may not be found in lesser developed financial centers. Hence, transactions monitoring becomes all the more important, where the money is actually coming in and going out. So who is actually the beneficial owner of these funds? Machine-readable passports provide maximum security features. For example, using world checks, passport check, you can verify such passports. Other than where only the photo has been replaced. So if other things remain constant and only the photo has been changed, you won't be able to use passport check to identify the fraud. Lastly, do also read the UK Home Office false ID guidance of July 2012, which is in the context of alcohol sales, but nonetheless relevant. Moving on to the seventh typology, which is the abuse of gatekeepers. Gatekeepers, which are lawyers, notaries, accountants, trust and company service providers, and real estate agents. They are a common element in complex laundering schemes. Lawyers are key in corruption schemes. The methods by which legal professionals are exploited include misuse of client accounts, purchase of real property, creation of trusts and companies, management of trusts and companies, managing client affairs and making introductions, undertaking certain litigation, setting up and managing charities. Of course, regulation of gatekeepers without effective supervision may not be sufficient to mitigate risk. Moving on to the next typology, which is trust and company service providers, or TCSP. Lawyers play a key role. The availability of beneficial ownership information is key to prevent misuse. Current abilities of TCSPs is to identify beneficial owners is suspect, especially in complex or difficult cases. Effective regulation and supervision is key to fixing this weak chain. The revised 5540 increases focus on trustees for beneficial ownership identification and also offers a trust registry as another option. In addition, of course. So the focus on trustees is certainly increased. The next typology is an international wire transfers. International wire transfers can be by the cover method, which is 203 cover and then supported by MT103, which goes directly to the bank, or by the serial method. So you send a 103 and then the bank receiving the funds will further give a credit advice using the MT910, and of course other systems also for funds transfers. Data issues exist. For example, the data may be deliberately changed. So instead of giving the name of the customer, they say one of our customers in the cover method. Others, there's a data mapping issue, for example in the serial method, where information in the MT103 does not get translated to the 910 credit advice, or truncation across systems, for example SWIFT to BSES. BSES is a UK system. So wire transfers of course are used extensively in the layering stage, and certainly in large drug trafficking schemes, wire transfers have played a key role. Moving on to the next typology, which is new payment methods. Typologies include third-party funding, directly via anonymous products or indirectly using strawmen and nominees, exploitation of the non-face-to-face nature, complicit organization and employees. Typically in cases, they found that fit and proper tests either failed or were not applicable, or both. Laundering the proceeds gained from fraud following identity theft. So how this works is that they essentially steal from bank accounts, credit and debit cards through hacking and phishing, and then they use the monies to fund prepaid cards or internet payment service accounts. So banks need to take extreme care. Besides, of course, companies like Liberty Reserve have been frontline. But even well-established players have had both AML and compliance issues, including transactions which are out with the terms of their license. Moving on to the next typology, which is proliferation financing. This covers the funds or financial services from manufacture to end use of nuclear, chemical or biological weapons and their means of delivery and related materials. It includes both technologies and dual-use goods used for non-legitimate purposes. Profile of transactions includes operating in countries with weak export controls or utilizing free trade zones, abusing both the formal and informal international financial system, or resorting to cash. Proliferation-sensitive goods and services may be purchased on the open market. Banks will see ordinary financial transactions to pay intermediaries and suppliers, and acting through illicit intermediaries, front companies and illegal trade brokers. Existing export control systems, including the UN and targeted financial sanctions, example OFAC and EU, go a long way to mitigate risk. However, FIs have far less information about end users and ultimate end users of items underlying financial transactions. Information in transactions that describe items is generally too vague and or would require a significant amount of technical knowledge to determine if they were sensitive or not. So currently, to manage risks, many FIs either refuse new business with high-risk customers or cease existing business with them. Others ask export control authorities before proceeding with any transactions in respect of high-risk export sectors or countries. Moving on to the next typology, which is maritime piracy and kidnapping for ransom. First, piracy for ransom, which is PFR. So piracy is on the rise and is a multi-jurisdictional challenge. Ransom payments can be collected, consolidated and spent almost anywhere. Ransom payments are typically converted into different types of financial instruments or used to purchase real property and other fixed assets. There are two aspects: the financing of operations and the use, including laundering, of the ransom payments and other material gain from the criminal act. One of the mechanisms which has been used in disrupting the financial flows of PFR is targeted financial sanctions under both UN and domestic jurisdictions. Let's move on to the next sub-point, which is kidnapping for ransom, or KFR. Terrorist organizations in a number of jurisdictions, including Afghanistan, Pakistan, and the Philippines, use KFR as a significant source of revenue. Hence, this creates serious terrorist financing concerns to international financial institutions. A kidnapping can occur in one jurisdiction, but the ransom may be paid in another. Both the informal and formal sectors could be used for ransom payments. Those with the ability to pay a large ransom are typically located in developed areas with sophisticated banking. Hence, banks may be at risk for placement and transmission of ransom payments. Oftentimes, once a ransom payment is delivered with physical cash and cash couriers, which are covered by the FATF 40, so cash couriers are used to move these funds to the terrorist group. Moving on to the 13th typology, which is illicit tobacco trade. Illicit tobacco trade is the supply, distribution, and sale of smuggled, genuine, counterfeit, or cheap white tobacco products. It involves the smuggling to avoid excise taxes and to evade rules prohibiting the sale of such goods. It constitutes a significant global money laundering and terror financing threat. It's estimated to amount to billions of dollars. It's cash intensive and is laundered. Several money laundering methods are used: bulk cash smuggling, commingling, smurfing, structuring, nominee or third party accounts, lawyer or accountant client accounts, complex movements of funds including trade laundering, casinos, investments in real estate and entities, and of course electronic fund transfers. Moving on to the next typology, which is money remittance and currency exchange providers. There are risks related to clients, the owners of such service providers, or their agents. And they can be used for moving monies for criminal activities, including terrorist financing. There tends to be a low detection of money laundering vis-a-vis industry size. Moving on to the next typology, which is the use of alternative remittance systems or hawalas. This is typically to settle trade transactions to circumvent foreign exchange controls, for example, between China and Taiwan, or to move tax evasion money and other criminal monies, including terrorism monies. For banks, the examples of their prospective clients could include accounts of small mom-and-pop convenience stores that have foreign funds paid or received. Moving on to the 16th typology, charities and non-profit organizations. These have been known, of course, to raise terrorist funds, obscure the source and nature of funds, and distribute terrorist finances. Importantly, these are now also being used in money laundering schemes. Certainly, controls around non-profit organizations need to be watched at both the country level and in financial institutions. Moving on to the 17th typology, which is free trade zones. Typically, administrative and oversight procedures are reduced or eliminated in these free trade zones. Potential vulnerabilities could include weaker custom controls, for example, around trade fraud, trade-based money laundering, and tax evasion, weaker AML controls around company formation, goods purchased in cash and no customer due diligence on such clients, exposure to bulk cash smuggling, and opacity of transshipment, which increases origin ambiguity. Bankers need to take care with linked transactions and, of course, company account opening. Moving on to the next typology, which is trade fraud and trade-based money laundering. So this has money laundering, terrorist financing, tax evasion, and sanctions risks. Multiple parties on both sides of a transaction makes due diligence more difficult, and collusion is possible between buyers and sellers. High-risk goods, for example, trade in weapons or nuclear equipment, could be part of trade transactions, and it typically uses under and over invoicing, phantom shipments, and other falsification of value and quantity including multiple invoicing of goods in order to transfer value. A successful trade-based money laundering scheme often includes false documentation, which misrepresents the contents and or volume of cargo. It includes a number of complex layers, including cash, front companies, currency exchange, and purchase and shipment of goods with illicit proceeds. Country risk is very important in analyzing trade money laundering risks. And I would strongly recommend the usage of independent services such as ICC's Commercial Crime Services, which is a UK service, using their due diligence services for trying to figure out counterparties in trade. And of course, documentation scrutiny also. So moving on to the next typology, which is telecom fraud. I'm going to give you an example to illustrate this. For example, a China and Taiwan major fraud ring. So the network is connected via various Southeast Asian countries, and fraudsters impersonate police and others, and they want money to drop laundering charges, and in banks, of course, such monies will show up in cash transactions. Let's move on to the 20th typology, which is tax evasion. Tax evasion is now a FATF predicate offense for money laundering, which means that there's going to be a lot more information exchange on tax evasion through the money laundering channels. Banks need to do a review of existing clients and new clients to identify higher risk clients. Banks should look at negative factors and positive factors. Negative factors could be things like negative news, which is already existing on files, negative news, use of complex structures, third parties, hold mail, and of course the tax residence of the client versus their domicile. Also look at positive factors. For example, do they have a Big Ten tax advisor? Do they make tax payments from the bank account? Or any other confirmation on tax compliance available to the bank? Perform enhanced due diligence where needed, including negative news, transactions review, and beneficial ownership verification. Let's move on to the 21st typology, which is proceeds of value-added carousal fraud. This is essentially a tax evasion scheme. And let's take an example where Taiwan has 0% value-added tax on exports, which is actually the case. So UK companies, let's call them missing trader, basically import goods from value-add tax-free countries like Taiwan and sell them in UK with value-added tax. They pocket the VAT and they disappear. Mobile phones is a good example of goods used, which is expensive and easily transported. So VAT carousel fraud is typically managed by an organized crime ring with multi-country networks. Sometimes the customer may be part of the fraud and may resell to a bogus company in another country, file for a VAT refund, sell back to the missing trader, and then the same round is repeated again and again. Countries could get caught up in this domestically or internationally. Carbon credits, which is emission trading, has fallen victim to this type of fraud. And this will show up in transactions of small companies, including some linked with tax authorities for refunds. The next typology is on dealers in precious metals and stones. So such dealers essentially help to convert illicit proceeds into precious metals, stones, and foreign currency, which then get moved using cross-border couriers. The tradition of secrecy in this sector makes it difficult for law enforcement, even if KYC and SDR rules apply in many countries. The next typology is in the security sector. The security sector, as you're aware, the product offerings are vast and many are complex, and there are new products and services all the time. It's very attractive for money laundering owing to the speed in executing transactions, the global reach, and the adaptability of this sector. Money laundering and terrorist financing, tax evasion and securities fraud, insider trading, market manipulation, it's a victim to all this. Areas of vulnerability include rogue employees and money laundering schemes involving products, for example derivatives, and certain transaction types. Enhanced due diligence areas include offshore trusts, non-profit organizations and charities, significant cross-border activity, internet/online accounts, omnibus and private banking accounts. This sector typically has low SDR reporting. However, it is possible to manage risks. So for example, a securities firm may have a no cash policy or may say no third party payments, no unrelated third party payments, no changes to enable payments from and to third parties, and the first check should be from a local bank account, etc. So the ways of mitigating risk for the security sector. The next typology is number 24 on casinos. So casinos, of course, bring money laundering risks. They have a lot of money laundering risks. They're cash intensive. You could deposit, underplay, and take out a check or draft for the remainder. You could buy funds, underplay or don't play, and take out the funds, or you pay to third parties. You use the casino chips as currency. To the extent that casino transactions are account-based, effective customer due diligence and enhanced due diligence practices help. Junket operators, which are basically tour agents for high roller clients in VIP rooms, and you know, the ones which are really high risk are the ones in Macau. So junket operators facilitate FEX violations and prostitution, and they also lend money, and the source of this these loans is often questionable. The funds transfer mechanism via junkets also obscures the source and beneficial owner of funds. Enhanced due diligence on junkets is an important control, and this sector has risks of staff complicity. For example, the non-filing of suspicious transaction reports and currency transaction reports, or the falsifying and destruction of records. Worst is, of course, if the casino is owned by criminals. A separate regulatory authority is needed for both CTR and SDR. Both of these are needed, and junket oversight is very critical. Number 25, which is the real estate sector. So schemes include things like intercompany loans, you know, back-to-back schemes, etc., including collateral to banks, lawyer trust accounts, offshore shell companies and trusts, management companies, overvaluing and undervaluing schemes, cash purchases, loan repayments. So basically, through investment schemes in the real estate sector, banks or other financial institutions may get used by third parties to launder money. Integration stage investments in hotels, restaurants, or other similar investments are typically made. Advantages include that these are, of course, cash intensive businesses, which can subsequently also be misused if they want to. So let's look now at the others category of typologies. I'm going to discuss OFAC Iran sanctions briefly, and some will ask why is this in an AML typologies list, but I'm going to answer that. So OFAC sanctions are typically, Iran sanctions are typically focused on the entire petroleum and financial sector. So OFAC Iran sanctions and AML risk. OFAC Iran sanctions tend to be focused on the entire petroleum and financial sector. So the US can assert US jurisdiction over non-US persons based on limited and indirect contacts with the US. More directly, foreign financial institutions can be banned from opening accounts and maintaining US correspondent accounts or payment through accounts. It's very important that database scrutiny is done of related entities, so entities related to sanctioned persons, and the ownership of vessels. That's because the ownership of vessels tend to get moved from one entity to another in order to evade sanctions. And of course, there's some very good databases which can help you in both these items of scrutiny. So in terms of money laundering risk, you've got Section 311 designation under the Patriot Act. And Iran is a primary money laundering concern, and this hits out at the entire financial system. So foreign financial institutions dealing with Iran banks may find themselves similarly designated. So it's important to know when you're dealing with Iran that if you don't get caught up with the sanctions piece, you can definitely get caught up with the AML piece. So the last item is in securities fraud, the last typology. So securities fraud covers things like insider trading and market manipulation. It tends to be managed by general compliance, although SAR filing or SDR filing is required through the AML team. Technology usage will certainly help to detect such activities, and larger banks typically have zero tolerance for clients who have done this at their bank.